we're inviting you on this evening started with a what if question around a kitchen table. What if we could navigate this trailblazed ship into new, uncharted waters and ask what it really means to be Irish in 2014?
Not alone in Ireland, but across the world, our institutions losing their credibility. And in a way that might not be a bad thing, because it is time for a new conversation. A new conversation from the centre.
Dirive, benacht de oriv. Dirive means God be with you. Benacht de oriv, may the blessings of God be on you. It said that you cannot speak Irish and be agnostic.
I believe that story is extraordinarily potent. All of life is lived through story. The stories we internalize about ourselves, our self-worth, our lack of it. Story is how we make meaning of our lives. Every waking minute we're bombarded by story. And when we go to sleep, we're flooded by the stories in our dreams. Stories about our deeper selves, told to us by a profound and master storyteller deep within us that we don't even know.
The future is what we build together, and that can be an ugly, vulgar extension of what we already are, or it can be an invitation to the reality of what we might become.
The gift of imagination, ladies and gentlemen, is a universal sensibility within us all. It strives to make visible the invisible. It strives to make visible the ineffable, the unfathomable. It bridges the gaps between words and thoughts. In my humble opinion, imagination is a massive catalyst for change.
When I was a kid, I missed a sudden death penalty that cost my parish an All-Ireland title. And to this day, that is something that I feel no small amount of disgust with myself about. But my therapist suggests that I imagine that a young Eleanor is in the room with us, and she asks me, what would you say to that Eleanor? Would you say that it was her fault? I say, of course. She kicked the ball. I'm proposing to you that we attempt to put Ireland in therapy, and to do that I'd like you to imagine that there is a 7-year-old Ireland in the room. I'm going to say the things that happened to it, and each time if you would do your part of telling Ireland that it wasn't your fault.
Every smile, every kindness, every sneer, every cruelty. We can choose the shape of our future, or we can let it happen to us and have that future defined not by our actions, but by our failures to act. We can seize this day and every one that will follow. We can be great. We can be great. We are Ireland.
I decided to abandon what I thought I knew and to go looking for answers. Looking for answers among the people of Ireland. This was a kind of personal pilgrimage, a quest to find hope in a country that can be sometimes difficult to love. I travelled north and south, east and west, and I interviewed hundreds of people. I encountered a warmth, a kindness, a generosity and a community spirit that I'd somehow started to forget about. I also heard stories of hardship, about people losing their jobs, about broken-hearted families who had lost loved ones to suicide. I saw real suffering in a land where tens of thousands of young people continue to leave and where many of our elders live in fear. But from within the pain and anger, I also discovered a different Ireland, one that refuses to give up, an Ireland that holds on to a different dream for how things can be.
Every scrap of food on our plates because we're only six generations away from a famine. That we can't answer questions directly because of 800 years of trying to outwit the English. The stealing of Trevelyan's corn. The repression of our glorious and righteous human sexual desires by the Catholic Church.
St. Patrick, an Englishman, kidnapped by Irish traders, sold into slavery as a sheep boy, and then who escapes to the continent and finds out about Christ there. But these Christian trailblazers brought Ireland's golden age of stone carving and high crosses, illuminated manuscripts, the gold and silver craftsmanship, and these transcendental monasteries like Clonmacnoise and Glendalough, centres of art and mind expansion. We were, for a while, this thriving but isolated oddity on the margins of a great European civilization.
Wiping the six counties off of us. De Valera commiserating with Germany on the death of Hitler. Roy Keane leaving the Irish team in Saipan. The inevitable emotional distance between the Irish people and our diaspora. Jerry Conlon being put in prison for 15 years for something he didn't do.
We live every day in Ireland with addiction because whether we've experienced it or not, we can't avoid it. It's in our faces because it's on our streets. When we live with addiction, what else do we live with? We live with what can't be said. We live with the holes inside of us that run so deep they can't be filled. I think for a long time we filled these holes with religion. And then when our belief ran out, we filled them with money, and we've always had drink and drugs. When I say holes, I mean trauma. I'm talking about the things that are so painful they can't be talked about. I'm talking about what's too painful to accept. The word addiction comes from the Latin. It means without voice. Ireland is an addict. Many people here have never had a voice. We were all born innocent. We were all once cuddly little babies in prams. So how does anyone become a heroin addict? I've met a lot of heroin addicts, and every one of those people have told me that they were sexually abused. It's not surprising when you think that heroin is one of the strongest painkillers you can get. Can you see the link? This is one of our national traumas. This is a huge part of what still needs to be voiced. We'll be right back.
to walk through the portal, to become the acrobat of imagination, to follow the invisible thread, the magical invisible thread of your own existence. And now you become a planetary acrobat of imagination, following that thread and looking, gazing out upon the wide, wondrous world. Maybe Ireland is a little like that acrobat, and we're in that place of suspension. We're trying to work out the balance and weight of past, the concentration of past, the addition and the subtraction of past. Tonight, I think we're drawing out the shape of us, the weight of us, the state of us, the whole unfettered soul of us.
Religion is based on story, genocide is based on story, love is based on story. And recovery in this country, emotional, psychological and spiritual recovery, will also be based on story. The story we choose to tell ourselves about ourselves. The writer Ben Okri has said, "A people are as healthy and confident as the stories they tell themselves." But he also said, "Sick storytellers make nations sick."
That we've never had an Irish Pope. That we've never had an Irish person in space. The sale of our oil and gas to Shell for a handful of magic beans. When Miley took Fidelma for a roll in the hay. Ben Dunn taking cocaine in Florida. Peter Stringfellow trying to open up a strip club in Parnell Street. How dare he?
With the collapse of the Roman Empire and then this flooding down of heathen hordes of Goths and Vandals and Visigoths, the old order, the civilization in Christianity, was destroyed, bringing about the Dark Ages. And it was left up to us, the eccentric, spiritually promiscuous Christian hobbits, to go back and bring our hippie spirituality to Europe. We became, for a while, lighthouses in Europe, shining out, steering people back out of the darkness. Could we do the same again? Yes, of course, but maybe what's best now is that we reconnect to who we really are, to the land that nourishes us, and to those snakes that St. Patrick went and banished. Like, we need our snakes. Snakes have always been a symbol of transformation, of man's ability to shed their old skins. We need to shed our old skins of victimhood and colonial oppression and to emerge revivified. The power is within us. It always has been.
As a storytelling people, we're at a crossroads in this country. We need to be extremely vigilant about the stories we choose to tell ourselves. We need to make a choice between the stories that shrink life and the stories that expand it. The stories that allow us to breathe and to grow and to flourish. Hamlet said, "There is nothing either good or bad, but thinking makes it so." When we are stripped of everything, we still have one extraordinary power left to us, the power to choose how we think about it. And if ever there was a time for us to tap into story for the life force that it is, it's now.
There's a story told one time about Fionn Mac Cool and the Fenians, Fionn Mac Cool and the band of warriors that travelled across Ireland. And once upon a time, they sat down at a campfire, and a conversation arose as to what was the most beautiful sound. And as each warrior gave his opinion, the first warrior said he felt the most beautiful sound was the song of the skylark. The next warrior said it was the song of the blackbird. The next warrior said it was the sound of the ocean. Someone else said it was the bellow of the stag in the autumn. And when it came to Fionn Mac Cool, he thought for a while, And he said, the most beautiful sound, he said, is the music of what happens. And the music of what happens in Ireland, our long story on the island, our relationship with the mountains and the rivers, that long story, the ancestral song, the path woven by our ancestors, that is still the deepest certainty. That is still the solid foundation. And to go through life without knowing that is fatal. Whoever you are, no matter how lonely, the world offers itself to your imagination, calls to you like the wild geese, harsh and exciting, over and over announcing your place in the family of things.
Place of sounds, of music and words and pictures. We are Ireland. We are of this place. We the inheritors of all that has come before us and the shapers of all that will follow. Lives that resonate in the stones of this place.
Where once
tampering with that sample. Thierry Henry's handball. Louis Walsh and his mediocrity factory. Oliver Cromwell's careerism. The space around Ryan Tuberty that he doesn't take up.
We don't need to be anyone's best little country for anything. We just need to be the best that we can be for ourselves and for those who will follow. There can be no better. We are the 6 million on this beautiful island and the 70 million beyond it. And we are Ireland, all of us, every day in all we do. By our actions or our failures to act, we evoke our past. We make manifest our present and we define our future.
Anglo-Irish Bank. All of the other banks. For the lazy, low expectation politicians that we had in the boom. The Celtic Tiger property bubble. Actually, maybe that was a bit of our fault, but shh, it's gonna be okay. It's gonna be okay.
Thank you.
we need to talk about Ireland. There is too much hatred, violence, anger, and recrimination. We need to turn ourselves inside out. Ireland of the Welcomes must start by welcoming every aspect of ourselves. It is still possible for those of us who live on this island in the second decade of the 21st century to shape our future as we see fit.
That we need.